Well, an adventurous prison movie is unfortunately still timeless. Maybe not the adventurous part of it, but the imprisonment. And I think that's what Charlie and I and Rami talked a lot about, is the relevance of imprisonment and what it does to the human soul. And what intrigued me about the Papillon story in the book is, and in real life as well, when you look at the characters, is the love story, the bond between these two men, and how they start hating each other, and at the end, They've bonded and they've developed a friendship through pain. And I was intrigued about doing a movie written in blood, with mostly shot on one location, but with a big huge budget, but still having a focus on the performances and on the characters. And I think that's due huge credit to the whole cast and to Charlie, of course, that we made it to here.
Can you tell us what you think are the qualities that Charlie has as an actor, the unique qualities that made him the right fit for this challenging role?
Well, Charlie totally submerges himself in the universe. And this time the universe is very limited, not in scope, but limited because it's a prison. So I think it was quite adventurous to try to see if you could break Charlie Hunnam. I don't know if I succeeded, but I certainly tried.
My final question. Rami is, of course, another incredibly exciting and versatile young actor. Can you talk a little bit about what fans can expect from this performance and the chemistry that clearly exists between him and Charlie?
Well, the chemistry, I think, is unique, especially because they have to go through this journey. You know, for me, they are my Richard Gere and Julia Roberts. You know, it's a love story, and I think what you can gain out of the performance is the uniqueness in Rami in his vulnerability, and the uniqueness in Charlie of his way of submerging into a role. And I think when you see those things together, I think something magical happens.
It's a prison film. I played a prison warden, so I'll control all these little. First of all, the director, he's phenomenal. He made some really unbelievable films. I think that was the first and foremost thing that sort of, I was scared initially, because I thought, why on earth would you remake that film? Because it might be the reason that I started acting that film. But I talked with him and I talked with Michael, and he so much had his own vision, and I saw it last night for the first time, and it's its own beast. I didn't think about the original once, and that I was really surprised by that. Rami and Charlie have really sort of made their own thing, and of course, because I'm the prison warden, I was not there while he was doing all their most intimate scenes. And I love the way what they have created. What drew me also was that whole prison thing, the fact that you are in one location, and it's almost theatrical. You know, you're there in this one location, and that's it. That's where it happens. And I really enjoy that.
Can you talk about, for you, the qualities that particularly Charlie and Rami have as actors that make them such an extraordinary good fit for this material?
Well, the funny thing is that they have such extremely different, they come from such different worlds. Not only, I mean, that Charlie is English and Rami is American, but they have different ways of working, and to see them from, and you see that, and the wonderful thing was that we shot it chronologically, so the relationship develops throughout the film. And what they do with it is, especially, in the beginning you think like they're sort of circling around each other, and then the longer they are there, that you see that love affair almost coming into existence. And you understand it. You understand every time that Charlie, Charlie's character gives up something, or gives up his own freedom for that friendship, you go for it. It's remarkable. Michael is a European director, and so he sort of, quite a few of the scenes that you see in the film are improvised, and that's him. He doesn't like the sort of rehearsed stuff, or he does the rehearsed stuff and then say, now go for it, or take it wherever you want to take it. And for an actor, that's phenomenal to do. That's great stuff. That's exciting. And you see that. You see people doing stuff for the first time and trying things out. And and the sheer smallness of it is beautiful. You know, if people would take out of it that incarceration, long time incarceration, is ridiculous, like you see it in many countries, I think that'd be fantastic. That'd be wonderful. I'm not sure if people will give that. Mostly it's about a film about, I think, friendship and love. But, you know, there's so many countries that lock up people for such absurd amount of time that it would be really good if people would talk about that. But
what does it mean for you to showcase the film here at Tiff specifically?
Yeah, I was just talking to somebody else. I mean, Tiff and Berlin, they're my favorite film festivals because it's actually people that go and see movies. So many festivals are just about the show and the thing, and you can hardly get into a screening. But I mean, I go to Berlin every year because I love that festival, and because you're able to see practically every film that's shown there. And with Tiff, that's the case too. I think they're the most easy to get into film festivals. Accessible, that's the word I was looking for. It's one of the most accessible film festivals there is. And that of course is great because that's what you make films for.
I wasn't at all determined to take on this role. In fact, when it was originally offered to me, I turned it down. In spite of being an enormous fan of Michael Neuer, the filmmaker, and it's really actively been pursuing trying to work with him, and even in spite of that, when I initially got offered this, because I shared what I'm sensing is a little bit of a gut reaction bias about the idea of remaking this film. Which I shared it, and I totally understand why people feel that way. But then when I met, I said, you know, so I turned it down, and then another actor accepted it. And I thought, man, I might have made a mistake here, because I love that actor. He's a heavyweight. And then something happened with the film that he was doing, and he fell out, and they came back to me. And I said, you know what? I've been thinking about it. And I'd gone back and I'd reread the book, torturing myself, even though I knew this other dude was then had the role that I'd been offered and turned down. And I went and I started thinking about it. So then when Michael said, is there any way you could meet me in New York? Because he was in Denmark and I was in LA. I said, I'm actually in New York for the next 2 days. He said, I'm going to come on a plane tomorrow. You just like give me 2 hours. And I wasn't sure if I like wanted to get into it with him, you know what I mean? So I said, all right, I got 2 hours as well because I got this other meeting and I didn't have another meeting. And then that 2 hours like went up and he's like, you got another meeting? And I was like, nah, I was just bullshitting you in case I wanted to leave early, you know? And we spent 14 hours together. And by the end of it, we realized we were both obsessed with this phenomenon of privatization of prisons, which has been happening in the US and then all over the world. It's funny, the first time I ever came across this, it was my financial advisor advocating me to invest in prison stock. And what you have to understand, it's a rigged game because the value of those stocks raise and fall dependent upon the occupancy of the prison. But if you are then own the prison and get to decide, or at least be a deciding factor in how long those people stay in that prison, then like any commodity, it's trading at 100% of its value at all times because it's operating at 100% of its potential at all times. Now that's all well and good if you're a business person or investor, but if you're the person who did some small thing that was like out of character and they got embroiled in that system and all of a sudden 2 years or 8 months turns into 4 years and you come out and you're not fit for regular society anymore. So what the French government were trying to do with French Guiana prison colony was they were trying to colonize French Guiana. But to begin with, they had to cut down trees, build roads. And so this prison colony was really ostensibly a labor camp to generate money. And we thought, when we made that connection, for us, it was like, you know what? Forget the first film, forget this predecessor. This is a story of a real man who really, you know, who existed in a beloved, important piece of source material. And all of a sudden, like, all my reservations just went away. And I said, let's go make the movie we want to make and forget like that our predecessor, forget the bias, forget all of the inevitable comparison we're going to have to endure, and just go make a movie we want to make. So that's what we did. I just did a film called The Lost City of Zed, where I'd gone from 185 pounds to 145 pounds. And it was 8 months later when I started doing this film, and I did exactly the same thing that I'd done to lose all that weight the first time. My body just didn't want to do it this time. It wasn't responding the same way, and so I had to be really hard on myself. The first time when I did it, Velocity Z, I felt good the whole time. I lost 40 pounds in 10 weeks, but I did it healthy, and I felt good, and I was fit, and then this time, I just felt horrible. And so I wasn't very nice to work with, I don't think, on this film. Like, everyone's really nice to me here, but there's a couple like days where I was like brutal on set.
There's an extraordinary chemistry between your character and Raimi's. Can you talk about working with him on that? Because it's, I think, a unique relationship in cinema, really.
Yeah, I mean, that's like, that was our second aspiration with this whole thing. So we wanted to do a deeply satisfying, the one that we needed, a love story. I mean, we needed a deeply satisfying relationship. And what's great about these guys is that, you know, I have a theory that like that is very interesting in storytelling, to introduce characters, male characters predominantly, in prison or war, because it's this unifying environment where you don't get to see the context of anybody else's like life or personality that colors it, but you get the sense that these two men in this film are men that would never ordinarily enter each other's orbits. And then because of necessity, and this unlikely friendship blossoms and turns into what we hope is like a really satisfying relationship. Because that's ultimately the entire film, is that relationship. So that doesn't work well.